Hello, and thank you all for being here, and especially for inviting me to talk here. My name is Marisha Winkels. I was a student at Artificial Intelligence at the University of Amsterdam, and I also am now part of the data engineering team at Aidence, where we focus on, as the title already suggests, pulmonary nodule detection. So, about a year and a half ago, I was at this exact venue, and there was a workshop on deep learning and medical imaging, and that's where I met Taco. Taco told me a little bit about his work on GCNNs, and we mutually decided that if we want to apply those GCNNs that he implemented for 2D to medical image data, we would need to extend that framework to 3D with 3D groups. And, well, that became my master thesis project, and that's what I'll be talking to you about today. So, deep learning and convolutional neural networks in particular, have become the methodology of choice for medical image analysis. A drawback, however, of using CNNs is that CNNs typically require large annotated data sets to learn from, and these kind of data sets are scarce in the medical domain. The reason why this is scarce is both due to patient privacy concerns, but also because creating such a data set is a very labor-intensive process if you want a data set that is high quality, representative, and sufficiently annotated. All of this suggests that data efficiency is a major hurdle in the development of CAD systems, and this motivates our work to look for ways to reduce the sample complexity of CNNs. And that's what we do with GCNNs. GCNNs are CNNs with group convolutions rather than regular convolutions as a drop-in replacement layer that reduce the sample complexity of the network. And I will show you in this work today that we've managed to reduce the sample complexity for pulmonary nodule detection by nearly 10 times. So before we talk about group convolutions, let's first talk a little bit about why convolutional neural networks are the appropriate choice for image analysis in the first place. Convolutional layers, as you all know, apply the same filter at each position in the image, and thereby reusing the weights. Because we use the same set of filters at multiple locations, translational shift in the input will just result in the same translational shift in the output. This is known as equivariance. Because we also reduce the spatial dimension, the whole network becomes invariant to translation, which means that a shift in the input image will not affect the output of our network, so it will not affect the label, for instance. This is, of course, appropriate because for image analysis tasks, because images exhibit translational symmetry. But images and other perception tasks also exhibit other types of symmetry, such as rotation and reflection. Image of a dog rotates, of course, is still the image of a dog, and we want to classify it as such. So it is therefore, conceptually, it makes sense to look for ways that we can generalize equivariance of the convolutional layer to other types of symmetry than just translational symmetry, and it was shown that we can. That's the work by Cohen and Melling, Taco, my supervisor, and they introduced GCNNs that generalize the equivariance of the convolutional layer to other types of equivariance defined by a symmetry group. A symmetry group is the set of transformations under which an object is invariant with regards to some property, and in our case that property is the label. Before I talk a little bit more about symmetry groups, I first want to discuss group convolutions as a concept. So instead of using a regular filter with a regular convolution, we create an augmented version of our filter bank and apply a regular convolution to that augmented filter bank instead. So how do we create this augmented filter bank? We create this augmented filter bank by transforming each filter by each transformation in the Strozen symmetry group. And in other words, we create transformed copies of the learnable filter in other orientations. That applying those that augmented filter bank results in what we call orientation channels per feature. So a feature is detected in multiple orientations. And that's what we call orientation channels, and we get as much orientation channels as we have transformations in the group. The reason why this leads to equivariance to the transformations in the chosen symmetry group is that if we apply the transformation from that symmetry group to the input, that transformation will also be applied to the orientation channels, and the orientation channels will simply get shuffled. But the way they get shuffled is dependent on the structure of the group. So here I have a visualization of the structure of the group. The structure of the group describes basically the way in which transformations compose to form other types of transformations in that group. On the left here, you see it's a very simple transformation group, the transformation group of multiples of 90 degree rotations that's applicable to the square, so the symmetry of the square. You can see that by following the arrows, you can get every element in the group, every transformation. That's in 2D, but in 3D, we also have a visualization, and the visualization in 3D already looks more complex because we have more elements, which of course makes it more complex, but that's not the only difference. Another difference is that if you follow the red arrows and then the blue arrows, you get to a different transformation than if you first follow the blue arrow and then follow the red arrow. The transformations are no longer commutative, and therefore deriving the permutation matrix by which the orientation channels shuffle when you apply a group convolution is a lot more difficult. However, that permutation matrix is what we have to derive if we want to implement group convolutions for 3D, and that's what we want to do because we want to apply group convolutions to 3D image data such as CT and MRI. Now we've implemented these GCNNs for 3D, we can apply to 3D data, but to what data do we apply it on to validate it? Well, we chose the problem of pulmonary nodule detection. And pulmonary nodules are suspect lesions in the lung visible on a CT scan that may be malignant. A CUT system for pulmonary nodule detection will generally be comprised of two steps. First, you have the candidate generation, in which the full CT scan is processed to extract some candidate locations of possibly nodules, suspect locations. And in the second step, false positive reduction, we basically feed those candidates to a sort of classification network that tries to boost the number of true positives and reduce the number of false positives. For our experiments, we focus on false positive reduction in particular because this simplifies the problem to a simple classification problem, and this allows for a clean comparison between our GCNNs and regular CNNs. The advantage of applying it to pulmonary nodule detection is that we have a large training set available from the National Lung Screening Trial, which allows us to have multiple data set sizes to evaluate data efficiency. And we have a high-quality test set available from the LIDC with annotations from four different radiologists to see how well our models generalize. So let's discuss the experiments that we did. First, we created a baseline CNN and ensured that the CNN was achieving a competitive performance on the LUNA 16 challenge. The LUNA 16 challenge is a challenge for pulmonary nodule detection, and we wanted to make sure that our baseline without group convolutions was already like up in the top 10 at least of those participating participants. And then to create our GCNNs, we simply used the baseline CNN as we have, and we replaced the convolution layers with the group convolution layers that we created. Everything else, such as the training data, the validation data, test data, but also the data augmentation scheme and the architecture, is kept the same. Second, like I said, we have from the NLST, we have a large data set available, but we want to see how well this does on small data sets as well. So we created four different training set sizes of 30,000 to only 30 samples. And we train and evaluate our models on the same test set, but train it on different sizes of test sets. And lastly, our evaluation is done with a FROC analysis. So I'm going to quickly take you through the results. Oh, sure. Otherwise, I'll just shout. Anyway, I want to quickly take you through this result. So again, to reiterate, we have a baseline CNN, replaced those convolutions with our group convolutions, and applied this on four different dataset sizes. So here we show the FROC curve of the largest dataset sizes, 30,000 and 3,000 samples. We can already see that the baseline, the gray line, performs worse than the GCNN in every case. But we can also see that this difference becomes more pronounced as we even further decrease the dataset size. Of course, this makes sense, right? Because if you have relatively little data available, increasing the amount of data will have a stronger impact on your performance than if you already have a lot of data available. And the same goes for using a data-efficient architecture. But what I really want to show you is this bar chart. So next to the Frock curve, we can compute an overall system score for our models, similar to how the Luna 16 challenge does that, by averaging the sensitivity at 7 predefined false positive rates. And that gives us an overall system score. And then this bar chart, it visualizes that the overall system score for the base for the GCNN is, in every single case, it's closer to the overall score of the baseline trained on 10 times as much data as it is to the baseline trained on the same amount of data, which I think is really interesting and proves that it is, in fact, a very data-efficient system. Something I've glossed over so far is the choice of symmetry groups that we have. So I just said GCNN, but of course, when we implement our group confluences, we have to choose which symmetry group, which set of transformations we want to be equivariant against. And initially, the diagram that I showed you was of the group of cubic symmetry, which is, of course, a natural extension of the group of square symmetry. But as you know, if you've worked with CT and MRI image data, the X and Y spacing are often in a different have a different value than the Z spacing. So in addition to that, we also consider the symmetry of the rectangular cuboid with a square base. And also, we can not only consider rotations, but like I mentioned in the introduction, reflections as well. So this leaves us with four groups in total. I've just plotted these Frock curves that you've also seen for the GCNN just in general for the different data set sizes. And you can see that in most cases, there's no clear winner. There's no one group that outperforms all the other groups. And the scores are fairly similar. I've run this experiment several times, and the results are always like this. However, when we get to the smaller data set size of only 30 samples, the cubic groups do seem to outperform the rectangular cuboid groups, which is interesting. We believe that this is because as you have a fixed parameter budget, but you increase the number of transformations in the group, the number of orientation channels increases, and therefore we have less distinct features to detect. And for a small data set size like we have, you don't have enough data to detect all those different features in the first place to begin with. So the last thing I want to mention is that we also observe that if we plot the train loss with respect to the number of epochs we train for, this is an example for the largest data set, but this also applies for the smaller data sets, is that all the different groups show a very sharp decline within the first few epochs, while the baseline, well, doesn't. And this is, I thought, was very interesting. And we can explain this by that each parameter receives a gradient signal from the different orientation channels, so it leads to a fast convergence. I do have to note that this advantage of faster convergence is partly negated by the fact that processing an epoch takes longer the larger the group we consider is. So for the largest group, the one of cubic symmetry and reflection, it takes quite a long while. So to summarize what we've just talked about, we noticed that data scarcity is an issue in the medical domain, and we've attempted to reduce the sample complexity of CNNs by exploiting structural knowledge of the data with regards to symmetry, which gave us GCNNs. We applied these GCNNs to the problem of false positive reduction in pulmonary nodule detection, and we found that our results, especially for the overall system scores, are up to 10 times more data efficient. They perform as good as a regular CNN does on 10 times the amount of data. And lastly, we've also found that there's a faster convergence, and something we also discussed in the paper is that it turns out that our GCNNs are a little bit more sensitive to malignant nodules rather than just nodules as a whole. But for the details on that, I refer you to our paper. And for now, I'll happily answer any of your questions.
Thank you for a very nice talk. Are there any questions? There's one back there.
Hey, it's a nice talk. So there's recently a new normalization technique called group normalization from Facebook. I'm just curious if it is a good idea to combine this group normalization with your group convolution.
Well, I have to admit, I'm not familiar with that idea, so I can't say anything about that. But we did find that using data augmentation always works, so we can. But it would be interesting to take a look at.
Oh, sorry, maybe just a follow-up question. What's the normal batch size in your case for your group convolution?
30 samples.
Oh, okay.
Any question? There is one over there.
So you do data augmentation. So I have a question regarding the way you do it. Is the data augmentation at the image level similar to the data augmentation at the feature level, such that you get similar kind of transformation? Because if your feature transformation is stronger, you'll end up with better kind of generalization compared to the data level. So my question is that, are they equivalent or not?
Well, we use a lot of data augmentation techniques because, like I said, we wanted to create a baseline that is similar to in performance to some of the participants in the Luna Challenge. And of course, you only get that kind of performance if you use data augmentation techniques. So we used a wide variety of data augmentation techniques.
Okay, thanks.
Any other question? There is one right here in the middle.
Thanks for the talk. That was really nice. So one thing I was wondering, so with the group convolutions, you extend the domain and therefore also memory consumption and also computation time. With the group convolution, you need to repeat these convolutions for every transformation.
Yeah.
So did you consider for computation time purposes to reduce the group convolution set to only neighboring transformations, for example? Instead of in each, so you have the full domain, and then your kernel can act on all transformations, but you could consider only trying several neighboring transformations to reduce the computation time.
Yeah, we could do that, but that would mean that the transformations are no longer part of a group, so that would also mean that they're no longer equivariant to the transformations in that group. And also something we take a look at is, like I said, the convergence is faster for GCNN, so you really want to... Processing each epoch takes more time, but we have to train for less epochs, so that's an advantage as well.
What I really mean is you could sort of sparsify your kernels to only consider a certain transformations. So still consider the full group, but the kernels themselves, they only consist of four transformations, for example.
Yeah, possibly.
Okay, I'm just wondering if you consider techniques to speed up the code further whilst maintaining...
The scope of this project was really to see if 3D GCNNs are more data efficient than...
Yeah, and that's very convincing. Yeah. Okay.
I think we have time for the last question. This one in front of you.
Hi, thank you very much for a very good talk. So in reality, rotations happen in a sort of continuous space. So it's you've got SE3, sort of Euclidean transformations, but you're only considering a finite subgroup of 90 degree rototranslations. Did you look at the stability of your output of your predictions for non-90 degree rototranslations?
So, well, something we definitely discussed during this project was that Taco's work extends to steerable CNNs, which is for continuous rotations as well. And we could apply the same thing, of course, we could make those for 3D as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again if there are no more questions.